Hey everybody, this is the Computer Geek 01010101 here, and as you can see here, we are in the tech room, cold and dark, just as it was on Thursday, December 12th, 2019. Well, yep. And just as dark as it was a day earlier on Wednesday, November 11th, 2019, when this room went completely cold and dark in anticipation of Cherokee County Electric Cooperative Association substation maintenance. Well, guess what? That maintenance took place. Nothing eventful happened. So that's good. Only light in here is this Broncos light. Sorry about everybody watching in a dark room that just got their retinas burned out. Yeah, I know that problem very well myself. So anyways, I got a tripod here. I'm going to put this on the freezer for now. I did not shut the breaker off because my mini fridge over there, of course, I can't see it, needed to stay on. Apparently my dad is telling a TV commercial to shut up because he doesn't like it, and well, that can be said pretty well and true for most of the stuff on television these days, isn't that right? Yep. So anyways, we're gonna switch on the light here in the tech room. We are gonna pause the video and probably less than 5 seconds for y'all, if I be quiet and just cut the camera off. Well, now it's been more than 5 seconds, so who cares? Yeah, in a very, very, very brief amount of time for y'all watching, we're going to be on the tripod and we're going to be firing all this stuff up. So anyways, now that we're on the tripod, it was maybe 2 minutes. You can see behind me, that wireless router is off. And not a whole lot going on from that lamp, so that lamp's about as good as useless right now. So, first power strip I'm going to switch back on is going to be this power strip right the heck over here. I'm probably going to put this over here and just do a... I'm just going to zoom in on the clock there. What that clock is going to do when I power it on is it's going to show the date. It's going to show, I think, the day, then the month, and then the year, or the month, day, year, or something like that. And then it's going to come up. And then it's going to come up with a time, which will probably be out by more than a few minutes. And that's how a light bulb blows out. Oh, yeah, that's a rather interesting. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to turn this lamp off because I know what state the power switch is in. And that filament exploded hard. So now what we're going to do is we're going to turn on this lamp over here. And there we go. So now we have the first lights back on in the tech room. It doesn't actually look to be that far off. It says it's 8 o'clock. I think it's a little bit ahead. Well, behind, actually. I can verify that by looking at the camera's date and time, which is not figured out by going to camera mic. That's figured out by entering setup, going down to click. Battery info, power suit, date and time setting. This operation or setting not available as follows. Standby. Yeah, it's about an hour behind. Either that or I haven't adjusted the camera for daylight savings time. I don't know. But if you just saw a bright flash on the left side of your screen, well, I think I just lost my last GE Reveal 75 watt bulb. So that kind of stinks. But either that clock is dead on, or It's out by a single lonely hour. So anyways, next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to bring up the accessory power here in the tech room, and you'll definitely hear a number of relays click. We might even witness to, going by our look right now, we might even see a 150 watt bulb blow out. No, hopefully we won't, because that would be a breaker trip generating incident. Maybe, one time I had a 40 watt candelabra in my ceiling fan blow out and pop the breaker once. See, that was all nice and fun. So, what I'm doing now is I'm setting up the tripod. And probably giving everybody a case of severe vertigo. A trash can there. Yeah, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna adjust the tripod further. And if anybody watching this didn't have vertigo previously, they definitely have it now. That's better. Now we can actually see the power strip. So yeah, that power strip right up in there, that is going to be the first thing to come on. And what's going to happen is those fans are going to come on. These lamps are probably going to come on. And you'll hear a bunch of relay clicks as the stereo equipment over there enters standby. And we'll get real lucky. It might glitch out. It might actually come on. And then we get to deal with this fun thing called the copyright police. Which is absolutely lovely, isn't it? No, it's not. I remember I tried to upload Take the Long Way Home by... forgot the group's name. I tried to upload Take the Long Way Home, and YouTube's copyright police not only blocked the video in all countries, but I got a real nice, lovely copyright strike on my channel that lasted for 3 months. So that was fun. So, power strip switching on now. Well, apparently I cut the lamps out. And that's one of the things that happens when I'm doing a cold start in the tech room. One of these dad blame fans decides that its bearings don't want to play ball. And it's usually this thing. And I usually have to do percussive maintenance. But what? Yeah, first thing I do is I try percussive maintenance, and if that doesn't work, I let it sort itself out, because that usually fixes itself within 30 minutes to an hour of initially powering on cold. So now, what I'm going to do is we're going to kick both of these lamps up to a 150 watt setting, and now we can officially... And now we can officially shut off that. Not shut it off, i.e. power switch off. Like the power switch all the way, but shut it off, i.e. Clickety clickety click off. So there. And you might notice that the sound of the bearing in the background has changed. Yeah, it'll eventually clear up as it warms up. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to switch on this thing. This has what my guest gaming rig, and it's a pair of associated pair of computer speakers. This goes to my little voltmeter thing. Okay. I'm going to move... This is my phone charger for when I'm in here. Move both of those over. Plug three left. That white cord that goes to this thing. And then As you can hear, the bearing thing just cleared up. That goes to my external hard drive dock. This goes to my primary tech room router, and then this goes to my guest router. Oh, it helps to turn it on first. So yeah, so I'm gonna aim the camera up. I'm gonna scoot this curtain over a little bit. You'll see the lights on the guest router turn on blue and then start doing stuff, and then you'll see this light right here start blinking. For added effect, I'm going to turn off that lamp so you can see the lights just a bit better. Alrighty, both routers have started booting up. My line voltage meter has come up. It is recording 122 volts AC. Now I'm going to turn this lamp back on to its 150 watt setting. So we have all of our accessory power up. We need to bring main power up, and we need to bring, we actually have three accessory power strips in here, and then two mains, and then two main strips. Well, three accessory power strips that you can actually switch off. This power strip right here, it looks like you can switch it off, but if any of y'all have ever seen the failed motherboard destruction video, that's what happened to this power strip. Burned up a plug and welded the switch on, so that's lovely. So what I'm going to do next is we are going to bring up the main power here in the tech room. Now, I've never had it trip to breaker before, but there's always quite a bit of capacitance and subsequent related surge load that happens whenever I bring up main power because of all the switch mode power supplies and the computers and stuff. This monitor here, this is a hard power switch, currently set to the off position. So, that monitor should not draw any electrical power. And another thing that might happen to these speakers might go, whoop. But that really shouldn't happen because, well, these things are, now they're off. I thought they were off previously. So I was wrong. So, I'm handling the tripod differently as I adjust it to avoid giving everybody a super severe case of vertigo. You're going to hear a click when I bring up main power, and in this D-Link DGS-1005G Ethernet switch should come on. Power should come on first, and then you should see all five link lights light up green, and then everything should return to its default state. And generally, that's going to be I think there's going to be one machine on here which is not going to bring up link till I actually physically hit the power button on it, and I think that's the file server, which is going to be on port 3, I believe. But everything else should come up at, and there should be a yellow light on all other ports of the switch. So, main power up in 3, 2, 1. Well, they shouldn't all. Alrighty. Okay, looks like everything came up as advertised. I was a bit mistaken on what it did and how everything should come up. I thought it made all five lights come on one after the other and then initialized and then started showing me the true link state, but no, it just goes 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 and then shows me the true link state. And I was also mistaken on port 5. I should have said that should come up as a gigabit link because the that is connected directly to the tech room primary Wi-Fi router, and that is already on. So, of course, its network controller should be fully initialized, and it should automatically come up at gigabit at gigabit speed whenever the hub comes online, which it has. Another thing that's changed is the firewall server state. Before the firewall server, before the firewall server was completely active, like there were no lights on it, no nothing, now the firewall server actually is showing some signs of life. We have a amber, yellow, orange standby light here. We can see that one of our network interface controllers has come up, and it is currently sitting at a 10 megabit state, which is link light off and activity light flashing periodically. And as we can see here, this white cable, which goes to the tech room network bridge machine, that link has not come up because the tech room network bridge machine currently has no electrical power, but that is about to change. Additionally, the KVM switch should stay off because there is nothing providing power to it. So, I'm gonna pull the camera back, aim it up, and readjust it a bit. Now we're gonna open up the utility closet. Also like to call it the network closet. And you can see in here everything is cold and dark. We're gonna turn this lamp on. And I'm gonna pull the camera off the tripod, and then we're gonna get a very close-up view of this power strip. And then I'm gonna do some acrobatics to turn this thing on and almost make things fall in the process. So, water says no signal, network bridge machine stays off, and I think we should see link status change on the firewall server, which we do. We can see that the first network interface controller has come up at 10 megabit speed due to the link light being off, and we have a activity light that is solid green, which is to be expected of a machine on the other end of this being completely down. So I'm gonna plug the USB cable for the KVM switch back in, and I'm gonna put the camera back on the tripod, and then I'm gonna pull out this chair, spin it around, get it all set up and finagled into position and whatnot. Adjust this door a little bit. And then, oh, hi. and then we are going to start up the first computer in the tech room fleet. The tech room network bridge. Go. Monitor claims no signal because of sync status changed. Alrighty, you're probably barely able to see anything because this monitor is indeed cold. This is not a room serviced by HVAC services. And to top it all off, this monitor uses cold cathode fluorescent lamp backlighting. That's a lovely start to things. I'm also going to adjust the focus a bit. Alrighty. And I'm also gonna knock the exposure into something reasonable. There we go. So, close the camera lens because I don't want my password getting revealed. Alrighty. You can see the monitor flashing on and off as the system changes. As the system switches through various video modes, and now you can see a flurry of information as Ubuntu server 16.04. 1604.6 LTS starts. Probably not able to read anything here. But anyways, I'm also going to zoom in on the display. Not break the tripod control. Adjusting things. And you can see the system is continuing to start up. It does take a little while longer than other machines to start up, but that's primarily because this is a motherboard from 2004 with an ATA133 IDE interface connected to a 40 gigabyte hard HP issue hard drive that is probably running at ATA66. So I'm going to adjust the focus yet again. Sorry if that's out of focus for y'all. Okay, that's 0.7 meter. Let's knock it down to 0.3. I think 0.7 is a bit better. I wish there was a more convenient way. Oh, that's exposure. Oops. Menu, camera mic, focus, 0.7. Yeah, I say 0.7 is better. And this is pretty much what the tech room looked like whenever I brought this machine online for the first time. So, log in. And the first thing I'm going to do after I log into Virtual Terminal 1, or VT1 for short, and I'm going to switch to VT2. And I'm going to immediately log into it. And I'm going to start a TCP dump. Last login, Friday, December 13th, 2018. That's me logging into Virtual Terminal 1. Helps if I open the camera lens and not jack the zoom unintentionally. Virtual Terminal 1. Last login, Wednesday, December 11th at 5:21 p.m. So that's me logging in to shut the machine down. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to start a TCP dump. Hold up a moment. Alrighty. Dadgummit, will keep quick jack with the zoom. And right now, we're not going to see any traffic because the respective network interface is completely down on the other end of the cable. So I have two scripts in here. One is called bridge.sh and the other one is called wifi.sh. And what the wifi.sh thing does is it brings up a wireless card in this machine and connects it to the home Wi-Fi. What the bridge.sh thing does is it sets up the IP tables rules required for bridging and enables IP forwarding in the kernel. Both of these are absolutely 100% critical for this thing to function as intended. So, I need to run wifi.sh first. Enter my password. As you can see, successfully initialized WPA supplicant. And it's going to sit here for a few moments as it brings up the wireless card and associates it with the wireless network. And then the second thing that happens is it runs a sudo DH client against the interface to give the interface an internet protocol address. So now if we ping the outside world, like say 1.1.1.1, a DNS service, or google.com, pretty much all of you should know what this means. Not google.com ping, google.com. It does ping, and it does a DNS lookup. Gets to IP address, and as you can see, we can reach the outside world, no problem. Now, I'm going to clear the screen for simple, so that way it's easier for y'all to read it. I'm going to do sudo sh bridge.sh, and that is going to clear very quickly. It's going to give me back my terminal very quickly. And what do you know? We're up and running. Well, it is as soon as we get the firewall server and all the other core equipment online. So yeah, no traffic yet, but that is soon to change. What I'm going to do is I'm going to set up another camcorder and just point it at this particular... And I'm just going to point it at the monitor. It is 8:22. While we're at it, let's check the time. That clock is dead on. 8:22 reports the clock. Guess what the computer reports? Friday, December 13th at 2022:09 CST 2019. Yep. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab a second camcorder. I'm just going to point it at this monitor, and I'm probably going to put that up in a corner of the video, probably right around here maybe, or up here, either one of those two. So, we'll be back. Alrighty, everybody, we're back. I have a camera currently, if you can't tell, there's a camera recording the display of the network bridge machine, and that's going to be up in one of the corners of the video. So, I'm going to power on the monitor. Gateway VX700, a rebranded Mitsubishi Diamond Pro 710, featuring a Mitsubishi Diamondtron CRT. Isn't that lovely? So the first machine we're going to power on is the firewall server. Okay, the in-switch powers on the firewall. Oh, gosh. Find picture mode on, please. I'm going to adjust the focus. Alrighty. This memory count takes like 20 minutes to do. I'm not kidding. So I'm just going to abort the memory count, and then we're just going to let this thing boot. System status list, and as you can see, we have two multicast listener reports, probably to the router, probably to our primary router, and of course you're going to see more traffic begin to appear as the firewall server comes up. You're probably going to start to see a whole bunch of ARP requests start spilling onto the screen because, ARP request who has, and then multicast listener report, and now the ARP request who has begun. You can see Shorewall has just finished coming up, and now to log in. Also, I replaced a bulb in that lamp that exploded earlier. There's now a GE Reveal 60 instead of a GE Reveal 75. The only other slightly contemporary looking bulb I have is this yellow bug bulb. A little bug repellent thing. Seriously, my grandma has like an infinite supply of incandescent light bulbs, and it's amazing. So, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to find the whatever command I use to set the ARP route. There it is, sudo arp-s 192.168.90.254.
00110960B25D. Right now, the firewall server is trying to find out who has the broadcast address for my firewall server, which is 102.168.90.254. Scratch that, not firewall server, tech room network bridge. And then this right here tells the firewall server what MAC address has that. If you don't understand all of this, then I recommend that you go and learn about how layer 2 works. So, it's going to want me to put in my password. Alright, now all I have to do is press enter. Now you just saw a few things change. Now you just saw an ARP request who has, and then you immediately saw an ARP reply. About three one-thousandths of a second later. So, that means that this command I just did worked. So, now we're going to check the status of a few things. APC UPSD should be inactive dead, which it is. SSHD should be running. ISC-DHCP-server should be running, which it is. Shorewall, not exactly what I wanted. Shorewall should be inactive dead. This is the front end for it. What else should I check? Can't remember right now. So I can ping. Another odd thing I've been having is firewall server lately has not been able to get out to it, has not been able to browse the internet, and that's not a major problem. But things like sudo apt update fail, as you can see, because Shorewall is knocking out those requests. I can actually fix that by just downing Shorewall, using Shorewall clear, and then doing the updates. Minor inconvenience, who cares? So if I do w3mgoogle.com, that should immediately fail, which it does. So, if we do it, now we need to do an ifconfig, emp3s0 should say 102.168.90.11, and emp4s0 should say 102.168.10.1, and of course the local loopback interface should be up. All this checks out, so the firewall server is officially up and running, and we can log out. Now, let's switch to port 2 on the KBN switch. This is the firewall server. This is kind of important. Let's power on. So, on the switch, you might have just seen file server network interface controller just came up at gigabit speed. So, now we got to wait for the network controller to initialize all that power on self-test stuff to complete. Should chain to the bootloader, and then we should be off and running from there. And this machine is running Ubuntu Server 18.04.3 LTS. And of course we are it wants me to unlock the disk. Which it just has. Ubuntu 18.04.3. It probably just shot up the screen and out of view. And you might be able to see some network traffic. You'll probably see a pretty good amount of network traffic there it goes. You can see the network traffic up in the corner. Probably just saw some DNS requests to Ubuntu stuff. And now we have a pretty fair bit of network traffic. One of them going to secondary.economy.canonical.com, which is Ubuntu related, api.snapcraft.io. That'd be the file server. responsible for that particular network traffic, and there's a lot of network traffic now, as you can tell. So it's probably, and I can see it over the network, so type garbage, control C. Okay, that's weird. No caps lock. Last login and quite a bit of stuff to economy.canonical.com, and now you can see the monitor is just blanked. So I'm gonna go ahead and I would throw a AA battery at the keyboard, but I kind of care about the monitor, so that's why I'm not throwing AA batteries at the keyboard to wake it up. You probably may not be able to read this, but system load is 0.68, 155 processes, 30.3% of 3.57 terabytes used, 9% RAM usage, 0% swap usage, no users logged in except for me, and then the IP address for the NIC is 192.168.10.130. And the first thing I check is APC UPSD. And that doesn't exist on the file server because I haven't installed it. So, winbind should be good. SSHD, that should be running, which it is. This red text here doesn't actually mean something bad, it's just information. This MBD, that's Samba itself, WMBD. That's another thing for Winbind. NMBD. Actually, I meant System CTS status NMBD. That's working, so that's all good. So if we do a ping 1.1.1.1, you can see the network traffic on the network bridge machine, and you can see the traffic here on the firewall server. And you can see the traffic here on the file server. Okay, let's quit out of that. So, and if we do an NS lookup, that works. And if we go to w3ngoogle.com, as you can tell, this should work. Yep, which it does. Quit out of W3M, and just to be on the safe side, ENP2 is 0.102.168.10.130, which is good. So yeah, let's, this thing is good. Log out. Let's go to port 1 on the KVM switch, which should be the main office computer. Provided that nobody's jacked around with the ports and stuff, which nobody has, which is good. Oh boy. Let's drop the exposure. In fact, let's just set exposure to auto. Okay, that's when things start blanking. I don't think this has something to do with horizontal and vertical refresh rates. Probably a vertical refresh rate difference combined with tilting of the camera. Well, not tilting, but angling of the camera in relation to the screen. What have I done? Oh, there we go. We usually sit here for a number of seconds while the main office computer gets us all logged in. There we go, XFC 4-panel is started up, loading our icons and all our tray things and doohickeys. There should be a couple of notes things popping up. There we go. I'm gonna hide that real fast. So, as you can see, our network meter thing down here shows a perfectly valid network activity. You should start seeing a lot of stuff on the
network bridge machine in relation to network traffic as Chrome starts up on the main office computer and the thing goes wacko wild and crazy with blanking. And this is where manual... That just makes it worse. So I'm going to have to intentionally overexpose. Imagine we can fix that by going into the display utility and knocking the refresh rate down 5 hertz. And of course the geometry is a bit whacked. I imagine we can now set the exposure back to auto. And if we disable, disable dark mode, exposure should change and you have a very slow blank. That's hard to look at. 65.5 hertz. Go. Oh gosh, that's even worse. Oh, you know what? 20 by 10, 24, 75. Go. Okay, that's a... say that might be a slight... That's better to look at. That is for dang sure. It may be a shoehorn of a 16x9 resolution onto a 4x3 tube, but at least you can see the entire screen all at once. Of course, this is horrible to look at. So, I mean, we could go to bad caps. You can see the network traffic on the network bridge machine. Pretty decent amount of network traffic on the network bridge. Establishing secure connection. As you can see on the spinny doo-doo-hickey thing. And there we go. So now I'm going to go back to the display utility and see how much refresh rate we can get out of this. Apparently. Anyways, so let's set it back to 1600 by 1265 hertz, which is much, much better. It's not actually that bright on... It's not actually that bright in real life, it's just a camera. That's how I bring the tech room up from a completely cold and dark state to fully operational and fully functional. Of course, temperatures in here will begin to rise as computers heat, as electronics heat up and whatnot. So, looks like that's it. Of course, you should watch tech room updates. You should watch tech room updates before watching this video. Of course, it's a bit late to say that. Auto for exposure. Auto for focus. So yeah. Let's see, camera. This is the computer geek 01010101 here. Peace out, guys. Peace out.